Right, I'll go find myself, but I haven't, sorry, I'm relying on these two people here to kind of keep me to it. So, when everything the same is different, that picture is very telling. You don't actually need a lot more than that, but I will say a lot more than that.
So you can finish now.
<I'll be ready. laughs> thank you for your support. So, what we're dealing with here are the same characters set in the same place, so Riverdale, which is a fictional small town in middle America, but two different times in two different contexts. And so what I find interesting about this is what it actually, in that contrast, it manages to reveal something about youth culture as it is today, which I found really interesting, particularly being somewhat immersed in youth culture and youth ministry myself. So it doesn't, don't stress if you haven't seen either one, you're not that familiar, because I'm hoping that the principles behind it will be applicable and useful in whatever context you guys find yourself in. So let's kick it off by looking at the clip.
Everything's Archie. Archie's here. Benny's here. Brian too. Reggie's here.
To the 1969 cartoon version of Archie, which arose in the peak of the comic book's popularity. And we could probably sit and just talk about that for a little while and come to some pretty educated conclusions about what the cartoon was about, what the comic book stood for. But to kind of take it a bit deeper, I'm going to go back through the origins of where Archie came from and lead into where that brings us with Riverdale here today. So Archie Andrews, Betty Cooper, Veronica Lodge, Jughead Jones and Reggie Mantle are five main characters of Archie, as we saw introduced in that thing. And originally, they were not the headlines of the comic book. Originally, they were nothing more than sidekicks alongside what I would call your more conventional superhero. This guy here is a superhero called The Shield. Interestingly enough, he predated Captain America by 14 months. It's not Captain America, it's a different one. This is 1939, and so as you would have heard through Paul's talk this morning, this was during World War II, and it was at that time where people were really looking for hope. They were wanting to back America and be patriotic, and some of the ways they did that, particularly for the younger audience, was through media and through entertainment, hence why this superhero shield came about. And Archie, Jughead, Betty, they were just your normal everyday teenagers that would get alongside this super strength superhero guy and help him out with things, with jams that he found himself in. However, the creators of Archie, Richard Goldwater and Lewis Silverfite, what they found that this superhero lacked was the ability to relate to the everyday kid. So they acknowledged that the young people reading these stories, they didn't have superpowers and they didn't have sort of these epic backstories and amazing abilities, and they really wanted to be able to teach good values, good ethics and good morals to a younger audience and teach them how to be good citizens in a way that they could consume, in a way that they could understand. And because of that, they actually plucked Archie out of the Shield comic books and he became the headline of his own comic books. This happened in the mid-40s. And they began publishing Archie comic books formally in the 1950s. And so here we have Archie, and Archie is supposed to be your unlikely hero. He is characteristically clumsy. That's one of the things that makes him approachable. He's not your dark-haired, tall, dark and handsome kind of teenage stud. He's freckly, he's red-headed. He gets himself into trouble because of his clumsiness. However, he's a good kid. He is a nice guy who loves his family, he loves his town, and he loves his friends, and he always tries to do the right thing. And it just took off, really rose in popularity, and this motivation behind teaching young people good morals through Archie was something that really took off. This was something that motivated comic book creators so much so that in 1973 they partnered with a Christian comic publishing company called Spire Christian Comic Books to create a series of stories where Archie and the gang would blatantly teach the evangelical Christian message. And actually, courtesy of Matt Gray, courtesy of Matt Gray, look at that. We didn't talk about this. Matt came to me this morning and showed me this comic book, which I've already grabbed the cover of and put in there. But yeah, I'm going to pass it around. Don't worry, it has to go back to him. That's actually was given to him, he reckons, in about 1982. This one was published in 1973, so that's straight out of the day that it was intended for. And if you look at the jokes, the stories, it is about as Christian as it can be. There's no way around it. This is evangelical Christian messages trying to convert kids in the midst of the issues that they find themselves in at this time, this day and age.
But Beth, was that being, do you know if that was being published alongside the regular Archie,
I believe it was. They were still publishing Archie comics because they were a regular publication. These were a special edition. I think there were 12 of these, including one called Archie's Parables, where they actually took the parables and put them into Archie's stories to help kids to understand them in a relatable way. So despite the creators being Jewish, they partnered with this company because they felt that what they were trying to do with teaching good morals lined up with what they were trying to do. And so here we have Archie right in the midst of Christianity. What I find really fascinating about this example is this happened in 1973, which is directly at the absolute peak of Archie's popularity in the comic books. And if you think about that today, if we had any kind of fictional popular character converting to Christianity and starting to convert all of their buddies, I don't know, Harry Potter, Bart Simpson, James Bond, all of a sudden converted to Christianity and they made a movie where he's converting all of his fellow spies in Europe. This would actually just be insane. People wouldn't know what to do with that. But you could do this in 1973 and nobody would even flinch. In fact, I imagine it was probably quite effective as an evangelistic tool. So Riverdale, which I said before is a fictional town, these are nice, typical small town people in America. From the comic books of old, the classic comic books we'll call them, they are, there's not a lot of diversity in the town, they're mostly white. They share the same values, they're all quite educated, and they're all really good friends. This is your stereotypical nice town in middle America. So then Archie, our approachable, disarming, sweet, good guy that we see in the classic comic books, how does he become the Archie Andrews that we find in Riverdale? So to kind of delve into that, we're going to watch the trailer from the first season of Riverdale.
It feels like all the second hand throw.
Oh my God.
Every corpse has a tale to tell. This one has the touch of evil.
Archie, our kid is dead. I saw you guys.
How you feel about me? Is it real?
I'm asking you right now if you love me.
Who are you lying to?
I'm the Breakfast at Tiffany's, but this place is strictly in cold blood. This should be fun.
Do you and Donnie Darko kill the killer?
Nothing this bad was ever supposed to happen here. Maybe there's another side to the story.
The possibility Jason's murder will soon be in this room.
This whole car is a crime scene. No fingerprints.
You're a little more dangerous than you look.
Now, just as a little side note, because there's not a lot of people here and I can like sort of relax a little bit, I really wanted to do, even though there's not many people here, probably not a lot of people are familiar with the show, this is a Netflix original. And when I was thinking about what do I want to do to represent what popular culture is from what I'm observing, if you think about Gen Z today, what these kids are consuming is online streaming. They're not watching live TV anymore, and they're not going to the movies very often. What they're doing is they're sitting at home, they're watching YouTube, and they're watching Netflix and Stan. So I wanted to do a Netflix original for us to kind of have a look at, well, what is it that kids are watching, and how can we be immersed in this and become observers of this to inform the way that we share the gospel. When I first saw Netflix originals, I thought they were like the old, you know, straight-to-video tape movies that you used to get in the 90s. That was really revealing of the quality.
Some of them kind of are.
Yeah. but some of them have big actors, big producers. Yeah. Like, they're really well-made things, and it's because they're realising this is the future of media. So I do think there is something in us thinking about what is it that kids are watching, getting on Netflix even, and having a look at what people are consuming. So the 2017 Netflix adaptation of Archie, on the surface, you can look at that clip and believe that they have just murdered the Archie that we once knew. And the cynical reactionary me who watched it as a fan of the comics as a kid, I watched it to begin with, like they just killed him, and I'm getting really angry. But then I reflected and I thought a little deeper, and I think on some level the creators of Riverdale are still trying to hold true to Archie being a relatable hero, who if Archie Andrews popped up in 2017 and he's still this relatable hero that's dealing with the same issues that kids are dealing with, what would that look like? And even though it's exaggerated and it's made for TV, there is truth that's revealed in this, and we're going to get into that in a little while. So as you can probably have guessed, Riverdale is about, it kind of launches on this sequence where a body washes up on the shore of their town. It's the body of a local Riverdale teenager. He's been shot, and they kind of launch into this story of A, how could something like this happen in this picture-perfect town that we know and love? And B, of course, who has done this? What are the lies we're uncovering here? And as you begin to uncover the story, as the characters begin to reveal themselves, on the surface, the comic books, we've known these really sweet characters, but what in fact they're doing is concealing the darker demons that sit beneath the surface. And from that, you realise that they're all capable of doing terrible things, and perhaps any one of them is capable of murder. Now, I will just say quickly, if you are a fan of murder mysteries, please do not watch this show based on the murder mystery. It is hugely disappointing. It's not the reason why they have written this show. It's
I really appreciate that.
Okay, because I love a murder mystery. Yeah. And the guesses I was making were much more interesting than the thing that actually happened. I should have written this show. It's not the murder mystery. The murder mystery is the excuse to launch into a teen drama that is contrasting the classic Archie that we knew. Okay, so what I'm going to do is we're going to go through some of the main characters, and I'm going to do a little bit of analysis of Archie as they were, and Archie as they are. So let's have a look at Archie Andrews. Of course, he is our main character, and like the classic comic books, he is still a budding musician, he's still a popular guy, and plays football. But there are some very different things about him. So he's not the lovable klutz that we once knew. In fact, he's very smooth, he's very suave, he's very attractive. As you can see, they've just plucked a brunette and whacked red hair on him. And one of the things that he goes through is he's really conflicted with his identity between being a musician and being a football player, which is a conflict that the original Archie never experienced. He also is really rebellious towards his parents. If they ask him to do something that he didn't want to do, he finds a way around it, which again, one of the values that they upheld in the original comic books was really about family and obeying your parents and being strong families of America. But that's not evident here. He's also concealing evidence in the murder trial, lest one of his own secrets should be revealed. And again, that's just something the original Archie would never have done. He is still torn between his care for Betty and Veronica, but that story kind of takes a back step in Riverdale because he has another love interest, which I'll get onto in a minute. It's one of my favourite parts of this show. So that's Archie. And in the end, I actually just think he's not such a nice guy, this Archie that we find in this show. Jughead Jones in the comic books and still in this show is in fact Archie's best friend. However, classic Jughead from the comic books, the two notable things about his character is one, He loves food, that drives his motivation in life, and two, he is characteristically asexual. He makes it very, very clear in the comic books that he's not interested in girls, not interested in guys, not interested in a romantic relationship despite girls' interest in him. And but we don't actually see any of those two characteristics reflected in the Jughead that we find in Riverdale. Instead, Jughead is a brooding loner. He's an observer. He offers insights.
Hey? Should be made Gen X.
Yeah, perhaps it should have. He is an observer who offers this kind of wisdom and insight because he seems to be able to step outside the story and see things that other characters can't. One of the things that kind of makes him a loner. He is writing a book based on the murder that's happening in the town, and that becomes the narration of the show. So he has to kind of offer this wisdom that we see. He's also the son of a local gang member, and this gang violence plagues the town, and again, that's definitely not in the comic books. And of course, he can't be asexual because we cannot be asexual in this culture. There's no such thing for their sexuality either identity. So he's in love with Betty, and that unfolds in the series as well. Moving on to Betty. Betty Cooper, the original girl next door. Wholesome, sweet, always trying to do the right thing. Betty that we find in Riverdale is still trying to be the wholesome girl next door, but in her attempts to meet everyone's expectations of who she's supposed to be, she's actually battling some very serious mental health issues which cause her even to self-harm at times through the TV show. And she even seems to have these dissociative moments where she thinks she's someone else in moments of stress and extreme emotion. Even threatens to murder someone quite viciously that reveals her to be not this sweet girl that we see on the surface. She also is dealing with an emotionally abusive mother, there's no other way to describe it, and an absent father and an absent sister, and this kind of is a bit of a plot line through the show. Veronica is the only character that I feel is actually softened by this adaptation. So in the cartoon, in the comic book, she is elegant, she's rich, she's a bit of a snob. She's the closest thing we have to an antagonist in this comic book. She's Betty's rival for Archie's attention. But of course, in this show, she is in fact misunderstood. She is a victim of her parents' corruption in their wealth. Her dad's actually a jailhouse fraud. And she, in this TV show, is trying to atone for the sins of her family and the horrible things that they've done. So she's the only character that I almost like. My favourite one, Miss Grundy, the 70-year-old spinster music teacher. Is now gorgeous, in her late 20s, and of course having an affair with Archie. Scandal, scandal! They met over the summer break, and during one of their secret meetings in the woods, they hear a gunshot, which is evidence of the murder, but they refuse to come forward because they don't want to be found out of this secret love affair that they have. Reggie Mantle, despite being one of the main characters in the comic book, is almost unseen in this series. The only notable thing about Reggie is they make him Asian. He has about three lines. The token Asian if there ever was one, which is really disappointing when they had this opportunity to offer diversity in this very white town. Speaking of diversity, Mr. Weatherby, the principal, is now black, as are all of Josie and the Pussycats, which in the cartoon there was only one character who was black. And finally, Mr. and Mrs. Andrews, Archie's parents, are played by the only two characters I recognise when I watch this, which is Molly Ringwald and Luke Perry. Which, I found interesting, and I'll get onto that in a little bit while, about why I found that interesting. But what we see is that Riverdale is no longer this town of nice people. In fact, they are all broken, they are all flawed, and they are all capable of doing terrible things. So when I was watching this show, I kept coming back to this question of why Archie? Like, why did they use Archie as their launching pad for this teenage drama where if you stripped away the names, if you stripped away the character descriptions, this could be any teenage drama. Why have they chosen to violate on many levels this wholesome cartoon that we knew and loved to kind of make these statements about modern culture? And then I kind of reflected and realised I think what the creators are doing is trying to be three-dimensional in the statements that they're making. It wasn't good enough just to be any old teenage drama. Because they're actually making two statements to two different audiences. There are two people that would sit down and watch this show. First of all, your nostalgic audience that would remember the Archie of old. And they know who Molly Ringwald is, and they know who Luke Perry is, because they watched them when they were kids, and they are nostalgic for the world that they once knew. And what the creators are saying is, hey, you guys, you old people, you ones who remember and valued and loved Archie, that was you. That was your world. Those were the things that you loved. And this is us. This is our world. These are our struggles, these are our concerns, and these are the things that we value in our world. And there's something to be observed here. There's something to be absorbed and applied. This is what they're saying. What is it exactly that they're saying? Because if you look at the classic Archie books and you look at the things that the characters value and uphold, they're things like family, things like education, doing the right thing. So there's this sort of elusive right thing out there that all the characters are trying to do. Being kind to one another and kind to people despite the way they feel about them. And finally, their friendships. These are all things that the characters value, and that the creators did this specifically so they could teach these lessons to kids. All good things, but are they typical of the teenager that we know today, the teenager that we see in our churches, we see in our ministries, and our friends with and know because they're our next door neighbours? Instead, you look at the Riverdale characters, and you look in the bigger story of what is going on here. The values that they uphold are things like friendships and relationships. And when I say that, I do not mean family. Because when you watch the show, they actually have very, very dysfunctional relationships with their family. They all come from broken families. And in many ways, even their relationships with their teenage rivals are more healthy and softer than the relationships they seem to have with their parents. They really value their friendships and relationships. They value diversity, as we see, by the way, they've added diversity into this, and not just in the ethnicities we see represented, also in sexuality. There are gay characters, there are bisexual characters. And this is something that they value. They value their choices and their rights, and they'll fight for those things no matter what. They value justice. They want to see justice done in the world according to what they value and what that means. And finally, they want their freedom. They want the freedom to be who they are, no matter how anyone feels about it. And that kind of is connected to their rights. Again, if you look at the struggles that the Archie characters had in the classic comics and the conflicts, they were dealing with things like dating problems. We don't know which girl to choose between, or we had an argument with the person we're currently seeing. Homework, getting to school on time, trying to please people with grades. Misunderstandings and miscommunications, which is the basis of a lot of the conflict you find in the stories. They have arguments with their parents about curfews and pocket money. And they have to battle this elusive wrong thing. There are people occasionally who pop up trying to do the wrong thing, and they have to take those people down. Whereas if you look at the Riverdale characters, the things that they're struggling with are things like mental health, really serious mental health issues, sexuality, authority, they don't trust authority figures in their life. Identity, who are they in this crazy world? Broken families, divorce, weirdness, like just parents who are more messed up and broken than they are. And when you look at that list, that's not so different from the things that the kids today think about and struggle. Yes, Riverdale is exaggerated. Yes, it's created for TV, but what we're seeing here are real issues, real struggles, and real concerns of your typical Generation Z. And I think when you think about the meta-narrative, you take a step back from this comic book and you say, what's the big story that they're trying to communicate through the Archie series? And it's very typical of what I would call the conventional or the classic hero. When you look at Superman, when you look at Spider-Man, Batman, as they were, you see this story where there's this right thing and this wrong thing to do. And then you have our hero, and the hero's job is to pursue the right thing. They will fight for that, and they will figure out what it is, and they will pursue it with all their strength. And their friends, the right kind of friends, would join them in that pursuit. And so we wanted to be like those friends who would get alongside them, and these are the kind of people we could look up to. And if at any point one of the friends started to do the wrong thing, it was the responsibility of the hero to convert them, like to bring them back to doing the right thing. And if they refused to, that was no longer a good guy anymore. They're now the villain. The problem, the people in Archie, there are these sort of bigger characters who help us to understand the difference between Brian and Robin. And Archie is people like their parents, like teachers, like their authority figures, police officers, the mayor, those kind of people, maybe even God. You know, we said they released these Christian comic books, so there's this idea that even God can help us to understand how to do the right thing. Whereas when you look at the contemporary hero today, what they say is there actually is no right and wrong anymore because it's too much of a mystery. And this is definitely a story you see over and over again in Riverdale. What's right for one person is wrong for another. What's wrong for me now might be right for me later. And even if it looks like I'm doing the wrong thing, I'm actually trying to do the right thing above that. And so what they're dealing with is this whole world of uncertainty. It's all grey now. It's no black and white. We can't know the difference between right and wrong. And so then you find Riverdale where the contemporary hero meets the contemporary teen. And again, there's not this right or wrong, there's this world of mystery. Our parents are broken, our world is broken, and we don't know the difference between right and wrong. Our parents, our teachers, our authority figures, they're corrupted, and God is simply nowhere to be seen. So we can't rely on these people anymore to help us to understand this breaking world in which we find ourselves. Instead, the things that they pursue, the things that they rely on, the stability in their world, becomes their friendships. They don't look to God anymore. They don't look to authority figures anymore. They look to each other. And if you can't trust your friends, then who can you trust? What stability do you have in your world? And this isn't just true for Riverdale. If you watch any teenage drama that's popular at the moment, this is the story that is told over and over and over again. So the question I want to leave you guys with is when we're thinking about how we communicate the gospel, which audience are we communicating it to? Because I think the problem with the way in our youth ministries and the way a lot of resources are shaped is still in this old style of gospel evangelism, which is there's this right thing to do, there's this wrong thing to do. And we're going to help you to understand how to pursue the right thing so you can be good, wholesome people in this world. But the problem is that's just not realistic with the questions and the concerns that the current teenager has. It's much closer to what we find in this very, very shocking adaptation of Riverdale. They don't know what the world is anymore. So the question I want to ask us is, how do we become observers? How do we become students of something like Riverdale, not to learn how to be like them, but to ask this question of how do we, as ministers of the gospel, find ways to offer hope, to offer clarity, justice, and freedom to this generation that is begging for it? And all of those words are found right in the centre of the gospel, aren't they? And so there's ways of actually taking these questions and using them to become people who can contextualise the gospel in a way that these people can not only hear, but in a way that they're actually begging for a message to actually bring them above this world of craziness and grey that they currently find themselves in. So that's the end of my presentation. So did I say that?
About 4 minutes. Ben, I was fascinated if you were to take it back. Just kind of just responding to the question that you were leaving us with, the previous slide for that. But how do we engage with, how do we respond, how do we connect with people like that? When the traditional role of the minister would actually be up in that category up there, you know, with the teachers or with God or the authority, because we have different words for a minister in some ways. And so, what hope does a traditional minister have speaking to contemporary teens?
Yeah.
You would say, what hope is it? If they're looking at their source of identity and their source of wisdom and connection with their contemporaries.
Yeah.
So what it's suggesting to me is that we better redefine what the role of a minister looks like in terms of friend, guide, support, rather than authority and direction.
I would completely agree. One of the questions I roll around in my mind is, what is the church going to look like in 30 years if we are going to engage this generation? Yes, they will graduate from being teenagers and mature beyond some of the struggles that they're having, but those sort of central core values, are they still going to be there and are they still going to respond to the preacher who stands up the front, someone who tells them how it is? Probably not. But even if they are, it's still a question worth asking and thinking about the way that we do church and we teach people now. Yeah.
Other questions?
I'll go again, I mean, what we were looking at in terms of the comparison was like the 60s and 70s.
Yeah.
Did you do any research looking like at the more contemporary comics?
Yes.
Has there been a similar shift in the
yes.
as well?
There has, and the shift actually came when the original creators both died in the early 80s, and the CEO of the company went then to their relatives who tried very hard to contextualise it for a modern audience. But what you'll find is that Archie has kind of laid dormant. There's been a cult following, but a lot of people who don't respond to it like they used to, and I think it's because people value the classic Archie and what he stands for. But the way that I've contextualised it is very similar to what we see in Riverdale. I didn't get into Kevin Keller, is one of the key characters in the comic book. In Riverdale. He was a contextualised character who came in later, and about halfway into his career, I don't know, his story, we call it, he came out as being gay, and that actually became a really central storyline. So again, this is something we just never would have seen. The characters begin to deal with issues like the kids would deal with today, but I still feel at the core of it they try to kind of hold on to that ultimate core values, and Riverdale is up to something very different, kind of throwing a little caution into the wind, and they've decided instead to go with, well, Archie's been related with Hero, what does that look like today? What's related to today? They actually do a bunch of pretty cool work, like horror. They have these ones where Archie the Gang battle zombies, basically. and apparently they're very good.
Anything else? That's an interesting line too. Like the next X-Men movie that's coming out is a horror film as well.
Is that right?
Is it really?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
A horror film.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. As far as I can tell, it's not horror themed.
Yep.
It is horror. It's just a horror film.
Mm.
But,
I think it's called Archie in the Afterlife.
Paul was literally just saying that that horror films have been, there's been the biggest growth in those, like he just said that.
Yeah, so I've heard that basically monetarily, superhero films and horror films are kind of where it's at. Because superhero films cost money, but people go see them, and horror films cost nothing for them.
Yeah.
Just a bit of ingenuity, and then you can franchise them out forever.
Okay, well thank you very much.
Good
day. Fantastic.